Good to see you all again.
Lovely. Absolutely lovely. So great to be here.
Yeah, it's really good to come back to campus after about 4 months of traveling, and here in our little library area, we turned that into a little studio with lights, and we have some live audience here.
Yeah, I can show the live audience. In our little studio. This is our global library. It's into about 5x5.
And our blackboard there, I just noticed the other day, is we have one sentence written on the blackboard: teach only love, for that is what you are. I think that sentence has never changed since we moved in.
Yeah, we moved in, I put it on there, and it's just still shining. I don't even know how many years it's been. Everything is a blur, but it's right in front of us still. 5 years, we're getting
5 years,
our
yeah.
Cliff notes.
Yeah, that's good, because that's very consistent, you know, like it was the thing that we felt inspired to look at and live by, and is still today. There's nothing really that's changing from that.
Yeah. It's precious too, because I was just out with Kirsten for I Married a Mystic, and I had to kind of read through the book, get the quick cliff notes to remind me, because it was from like late 2004 to 2007, and I think, oh my God, that's ancient. I have to refresh the parables and everything. And then we've had, over the span of the last week or so, we've seen the Beatles and Snowden. And people may think, well, what's the connection between the Beatles and Snowden? But we're just in this blissful state where these major lessons, the major lesson is just kind of echoing and resounding. It's beautiful. It's the end of the world as we've known it. It's the end of linear time. And it's so glorious to live in that moment and savor it. And some of the highlights are, I guess from the Beatles movie, was faith and trust. You have to have faith in each other and have those that surround you that have faith in you. And it really keeps pointing to this idea that it's one mind and that you draw forth reflections of that.
Yeah. Because Beatles was very ahead of their time in their style, in their innovation, in music, in their inspiration, really. Everything was really inspired. And people, even including their manager or producer, they really had to trust. They couldn't really understand. And, you know, using the reference point of their understanding of the music at the time and people's reflection of it, they couldn't really know what to judge, but with their trust into, you know, this group, the group actually lead the way, you know, to a new style of music or anything. And I feel that is exactly what we want to bring back to our mind. You know, our mind is, when we really think along with the Holy Spirit, our mind is ahead of this whole egoic game, is ahead of the time of space. And then when we come back to think along, you know, within the time of space and thinking, is that okay what I'm doing? Is that okay what I'm thinking? Is people gonna be approved of me, of this way of thinking and living? Then we're going backwards, because there is no reference point in this egoic matrix, you know, time and space. We don't need to use this as the reference point. We didn't need to look around and see, are other people okay with what I'm doing? No, because you're leading the way, because the way that we think are leading the way of this time and space illusory matrix, really. So we have to really have trust in that, and we have trust in going that, we have trust in the people surrounding us that is going toward that, then we're going to bring this support and trust upon us as well. So that's something very inspiring, looking at Beatles.
Yeah, it's just happening. Like, yeah. Francis and I went to see the Beatles here in Salt Lake City on the Broadway theater, and then I do remember us getting in there, being called away for a call with Europe while the previews were going on, back in there, and then when the movie started, Frances was grabbing around in her purse to grab the Kleenex, and she basically was crying and bawling the entire movie. She had grown up in Beijing and really had not had an experience of the Beatles. And this movie, Ron Howard is such a great movie maker, it was such a full-blown experience of the Beatles that it's almost like she was right there with the teenage girls that were screaming, except she was just bawling. It was more intense, I think, than even what they were experiencing. Well, you could see it on their faces. They were having an intense experience. And Frances, right now, even just talking about it, her eyes are welling up. And then coming back here, and then I guess it was the next day, Frances just went into a full-blown mystical experience where she started to cut an apple, and then apple was so massive in her mind. She joined with the apple, and she couldn't cut the apple, and she tried to cut a lemon to have a little bit, something to drink, and she had merged with the lemon, she couldn't cut the lemon, and she just went into the all of all, the total bliss of total connectedness, the quantum field, the happy dream, the real world, and what's so beautiful about it was she was just telling me a few minutes ago that for like 2 days she just stayed in bed and couldn't read things, couldn't watch videos, couldn't do anything that wasn't connected to God. Anything that was directly connected to God you could experience, but nothing else.
I couldn't really even listen to music or Yeah, the only thing I, you know, because I couldn't really do anything or really read or watch anything, the only thing I thought I could do was listen to something, because the mind was awake and I couldn't sleep either. So the only thing that could really like help or feel like a union for me to be in peace, like in that state, was like a Christian mystic talking about the direct experience of God and oneness with God, and how God is, you know, the kingdom is within, heaven is within right here and right now. And that was the only thing that I could listen to for about 2 days.
It's so beautiful. I've got John Lennon singing in my ear right now. Whatever gets you through the night, it's all right, it's all right. Do it wrong or do it right, it's all right, it's all right. And you know, that's the funny thing, because I woke up when you were going through all that, I woke up in the middle of the night and I couldn't sleep either, and I checked my phone, and Frances is so sweet, she goes into a mystical experience and types out with her thumbs a little message to me on an email saying, I don't know if I'll be able to drive you to the airport tomorrow, because I was coming out to pick up Kirsten. And the reason I was going out to be with Kirsten is because Kirsten had just been in a mystical experience and had called me several days before, and she was overwhelmed and she wasn't sure how it would go with the tour. So I answer one call, and then to go out and support for mysticism, and then Francis blows into the mystic too, and she says, "It's cute. I don't think I'll be able to take you, but Sarah will be at your door at 8:45." So she signs off like oh, so she's gone too. So I think, wow, this is good. It's everybody's going into the mystic, and we'll just see what happens. I mean, none of us even know. And it was good because the morning came. I went in. She was able to function and talk and drive a car and everything. And I think she said Sarah's back had gone out, and Sarah was. And Dion doesn't have a driver's license, so those are the only ones in the house. So it was like she had to take me. So we go there, she drops me off at the Salt Lake City airport, and I said, "Thank you for coming back from the mystic just to get me to the airport so I can go support another mystic." And she said, "Being with you is like always being in a mystical experience." And it's true, because you know, the feelings that I've been getting and I've been sharing in these kind of gatherings is that everything's involuntary, so that's why you can have total peace right now, because you really are not in conscious control of anything in this world. You know, it seems like you can be conscious of raising a hand or lowering a hand, and it's just from an ego perspective, but actually that's an illusion too. The script is written. It's all a prearranged plan, and all you can do is behold it right now. You can't change the plan, you can't alter the plan. I still have friends that have been in the Course in Miracles for years, and it's still the hook of the ego still gets them when they read about, for example, a 90-year-old man in Florida, in Fort Lauderdale. I got sent this thing today where he's 90 years old. He's got a bunch of beloved people with him. They're all into God and Jesus and helping people, and Fort Lauderdale passed a law that you can be arrested if you feed the homeless. And so they've been feeding the homeless, and now the police came and they took this 90-year-old man away, and he said, I'll keep at it, I'll do whatever I can, but these are my people and this is my calling. And they now have an ordinance, a law, that says that you go to jail, and it's like a $500 fine, you go to jail or 6 months in jail if you feed the homeless. This is actually, and the police were feeling like they could hardly do their job. He said, "I think they feel guilty, ashamed to do their job, to take me away." But the 90-year-old man, he was so happy, because this time, the first time the police just took him, you know, shut it all down and threw all the food in the garbage. But this time they let the 90-year-old man feed 100 people before they took him away to jail. And the man was like, "Thank you." He was like thanking the police. "Thank you that you let me feed my people." Mm-hmm. Well, it's easy to get caught up and forget that this is a dream world, that all those characters and all those images about what's going wrong and what's going right and who's in need and the haves and the have-nots and morality and what's good and who's truthful and who's right and who's a liar and everything, all of that's a fabrication. All of it to keep you from this mystical experience where you're only in touch with God. If you try to save the world, if you try to save a human being, if you try to save the whales, if you try to save the planet, if you try to save anything except the mind, then you will be caught in guilt. You will get caught into duality of right and wrong. And even in the Course, Jesus says the symbols of love seem to play out against the symbols of hate. But how could there be symbols of love and symbols of hate if God didn't even create the symbols in the first place? How can that have anything to do with God if God isn't a creator of form, if God doesn't know about time and space? So this experience that we're talking about means that you have to, you know, say goodbye, like the Madonna song, "The Power of Goodbye." You have to say a goodbye to judging the world as good or bad or right or wrong, or this is better than that, or comparing this with that, or comparing teachings, or comparing spiritual teachers, or comparing, even comparing metaphysics, or comparing anything. It's like, let the name of God be your inheritance. Just, if you're going to have one last word in your mind before you let go of all the words, then the Course is just saying, just let the name of God be the safe replacement for all the other billions and trillions and gajillions of thoughts and words and concepts. Just let that thought of God occupy your mind so fully that that's the last thought that you think. And then let it all go. And that's what that mystical experience reminds me of. That this is our holy instant of release. We don't have to buy in to anything of this world. I mean, there is no good and bad in truth. There is no right or wrong in truth. There is no this or that, or here nor there. There is no me and you. There is no duality. There is no masculine, feminine. You know, you could let go of all the spiritualized concepts too, because anything that has two, yin and yang, no, you have to let go of yin and yang. There's no yin and yang. You know, we're blowing past even spiritualities and coming into an actual direct experience of God, of oneness. And to me, the best part of the best quality of it is it's involuntary. There's not some things that are voluntary and some things that are involuntary. The experience of the miracles are involuntary and should not be under conscious control, Jesus says in the Course. If you give yourself over to that, you will find your bliss, your total bliss, because you have no responsibility for the form of things. You have no responsibility to uphold anything. You don't have a responsibility to maintain an image, but you do have a responsibility to accept the atonement, which is really to give that cosmic image back to the Holy Spirit and say, listen, I tried to play with this image like a Rubik's Cube, like the movie Snowden we just watched. He has always had the Rubik's Cube going. I tried to do the Rubik's Cube with the world. And it's not my salvation, it's not my joy, it's not my happiness. I bought a ticket to the world, but now I've come back again. Why do I find it hard to write the next line? Oh, I want the truth to be said. Da, 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 da. I know this much is true. That's a very profound line. I bought a ticket to the world. I bought a ticket to duality. I bought a ticket to perception. But now I've come back again, back to revelation, back to the great rays, back to the joy, back to the intimacy, the glee, back to God, back to spirit. Why do I find it hard to write the next line? Because there is no next line. That's why you find it hard to write the next line, because there is no next line. I placed the future in the hands of God. I placed the next line in the hands of God, and then it disappears. And then you truly are clueless and carefree and cared for. And then you are truly free of the world. Roles, false responsibilities, duties, causes, issues. If you can hear, this is Jesus talking to you right now, and I'm calling you out of this world of perception. Perception, time will never content you. Never. You might as well give up now. It'll just save you this illusion of time and delay. But you can give everything over to this experience. You don't have to join a group. You don't have to join a church. You don't have to join a movement. You just have to sink deep into your mind, into the holy instant. It doesn't cost you anything. There's no price for it. There's no sacrifice required. There's no price to pay. This is everything. So that's what I'm feeling, as I've just been dancing around like Fred Astaire here, because I feel the joy in my heart is that it's all involuntary. It's all involuntary. And let's talk more about what that means. I've been talking a lot recently about how Jesus is in charge of the atonement. Jesus is behind everything. All I could think of when I was watching Ron Howard's Beatle movie is I smiled, I laughed, I cried, and I thought, Jesus, my God, what a story. Jesus was behind the Beatles. Think back to the Beatles, you know, think back to the early 60s. Anybody remember the early 60s? If you were around then, you know, war protests, racial conflicts, a lot of the same things that actually are going on in 2016. but if you think back, you know, to those times, nuclear test bombs being exploded back then was going on, and now Korea's doing it now. You know, it's really the same old thing rehashed now. It's not a lot different from the early 60s, but in comes this insertion of the Fab Four, and they start singing these love songs, and they sing a lot of them. I think Lennon and McCartney wrote almost 300 love songs, or beautiful songs, and it was an explosion of love, and everybody felt it. Mm. Everybody felt it. Mm. Even in China, eventually you felt it. When you felt it, it was pretty well blocked. It was a pretty good cloud.
In the movie theater, I felt it.
In the movie theater, she got the full impact of that meteor of light hitting the planet.
Yeah.
And then I thought the same with Snowden. I was sitting there watching Snowden, and Francis just watched the documentary that was made too about it. But all I could think of is, with a smile on my face as I'm watching it all, is Jesus is behind all of this. Even whistleblowers, even exposing, like what we do in our expression sessions, no private thoughts, no people pleasing. That's just more on a global level. That was like with countries involved,
yeah,
and classified information, and this guy, and people scurrying to use computers. But it was the same thing. It was just a massive exposure. And even that didn't matter, because Jesus is behind all of it, laughing, going, there's no private thoughts,
yeah,
and there's no people pleasing, and there's no privacy.
Yeah, I see it as like a global scale, massive exposure, age of exposure coming up, because there is anything that is hidden doesn't feel is natural anymore, and it feels like so much effort to keep it hidden, and it doesn't feel right. And I think that's what behind his motive to reveal, but yet what he is revealing, you know, underneath it is he's protecting individual privacy, but that is still is not it. Like in the end, there is no privacy that is really natural for us, and the privacy is keeping us locked in this time and space and believe that what we believe about all of this. And because of that, you know, everything, there is a right and wrong, there is competition, there is, you know, different races and fights and war, but all of it is because of this belief in private minds. And yet, you know, I think what he was trying to do is to expose some secret of the government and keep the individual secrecy, trying to find good in the wrong-mindedness still. And I would just say that we cannot find any good in the wrong-mindedness. We cannot find right in the wrong-mindedness. You know, the wrong-mindedness is all wrong in the end. It's all equally wrong, not because they're comparatively wronger or worse than anything else, just because they're not created by God and they're not true. So yeah, we can save our effort in trying to find something good in this time and space and protect that and fight for that, really.
Yeah. Again, I feel Jesus is right here with us again. Jesus, what do you have to say about Snowden? Did you like the movie? Oh, yeah, such fun, such joy. Seek not for your security in the ego. Seek not for your security in information and data, and protecting data and information. Seek for your Heavenly Father in the kingdom of heaven within. Stop right now foolish games, foolish pursuits. Stop and drop deep within your mind, sink in your mind like all the great mystics and sages have said over all the centuries, drop into the stillness. That is your home. That is your safety. That is your security. The security cannot be protected with encryption. The security cannot be protected with such silly things and bombs and missiles and defense spending. Be defenseless like I taught you. Be meek. Be as little children. This is the way to find your security. The security is in the mystical experience like Frances just had, where she couldn't think, say, or do anything. She had to listen to just the Christian mystics talking about God, because God is all there is. God is all in all. Give up these vain pursuits of trying to find meaning in idols, in images of the world. Be free now. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, thank you. Jesus. Oh. That's why he's laughing. That's why he's laughing at Snowden. That's why he's laughing at the Beatles 8 days a week. I love you. Eternity. It's not enough to show I care. You know, he can take any song that you have ever heard on the radio, anything that's ever been written, and sing you a love song like you've never heard before. You know, you ain't seen nothing yet when you look at the perception of this world, because it's only the great rays, the blazing lights of Christ's vision that will give you everything. And so everyone's being called into this mystical experience. Leave behind your jobs, leave behind your careers, leave behind your families, leave behind your possessions. Hold on to nothing. Dive into what is real and true, what has always been there for you, ever present, at your command. You can drop into it and have that full experience and go your way singing and rejoicing and dancing around like Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. Why not dance like Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers every day? Every day, so your feet can barely touch the floor. Dance over on top of your couches. Don't sit in them. Dance on them. Dance on the top of your couches. Go to your roof. I see Mexico. Living Miracles Mexico. Dance on the roof. Go up with Lisa and dance on the roof. Dance on the roof. Don't let it just sit there and wait for some rain to come. It's rare that rain comes at this time of year. Go dance there and dance in the sunlight and be free. You know, this is what we're talking about. There's no turning back. There's no looking back. And when the ego tries to come at you and says, this isn't practical, if this was so available, I would have found it before this time for sure. It's just trying to dissuade you from your joy, from your happiness. Whatever skills and abilities you have, the Holy Spirit will use them to shine the light. And you can count on that. You can count on that. Whether you can sing or not, you will sing a happy song. Whether you can dance or not, who cares? You just express. Let it express through you. Don't hold it back.
Break the ground every day. Allow yourself to break it. Like, don't look behind, look at what have been done. No, nothing have been done. You know, you are the one to break it, to do it.
You're breaking the rules.
Yeah.
Some of you heard there's this cable show, Breaking Bad or something. Break good and bad. Break good and bad. Let that be your TV show. Break good and bad. Do you really think a God of oneness would have set up good and bad? Do you really think that could content your mind, trying to sort out what's morally right and what's ethical right? That's so much into behaviors, which God didn't create. God didn't create bodies. God doesn't create behaviors. God doesn't have good behaviors and bad behaviors. It's just this love and light that's our reality, which is pure oneness. That's what to focus your full mind on. That's what we call non-duality. And don't just call non-duality as some kind of category or philosophical camp and then go on with your mundane human lives. No, oneness is actually something to be embraced and accepted as real and true. It's not something to be talked about as some kind of philosophy or theology. Oh yeah, I like non-dual teachers. Well, why not go beyond the concept of teachers? Really, I mean, isn't it time you laid aside the concept of teachers too? I mean, really, you know, those are human beings that do what? You know, it's like if you go into the mystic, all such things will seem so silly and funny to you. And you will laugh at the idea that you ever could have even believed in such silliness, in such ridiculousness. You know, let yourself have that experience and then let go of the idea that there's anything outside of you. That's really what the mystical experience is. You're just totally unified with God and oneness, and you see that there is no external world and never has been. And that's what happiness is about. So no longer will you try adjusting to a lie, as the angels told Resta. You can live life without reacting and responding to the images, without reacting and responding to the world, because you rest in God. And that's a workbook lesson. Sometimes people say, do you have a favorite? And I say, no, I don't really have favorites. But I do know when I was doing the workbook lessons that when I got to that lesson, I rest in God, I just kept doing that lesson over and over, day after day after day after day. That like was calling me to drop and sink. And I thought, I'm staying with this one. I stayed with I rest in God for many, many days. I didn't go on. I wasn't interested in the next lesson. I was going to go for an experience, and that's what we really need to do. We need to give ourselves over to that. So this is fun. Isn't this an out-of-the-blue session? Have we truly come out of the blue with you today? Out of the blue and the pink and the violet, we're out of color. We've taken out of the blue show and we've gone out of color. And I'm not talking black and white either. That's more duality. We are out of color. We have transcended color in this moment, this holy instant. Now, some of you, I think Sarah or somebody put out that you might have questions, practical questions, but in light of what I'm talking about, really. But we are really practical. Jesus is with us now, and the Christ presence is here, and you actually did receive some questions.
I did.
I think I might have answered all your questions, but we at least could look. There was a few questions that came in, wasn't there?
Yeah, there were.
Something about divine providence and...
Yes.
Was that Andy?
Andy.
Are you there, Andy? I hope you're there, Andy. You're somewhere in my mind. No? Andy Page. P. How do you. There's Andy jumping up. No. No, not that Andy. What's the Andy's last name?
P-E-J.
P-E-J. Andy Page. If you're listening, you'll see it on the replay, like the Truman Show. You'll see it on the best of anyway.
We're calling you right now.
Anyway, she's going to read Andy Page's, I think this is Nicholas's friend. I think were you on a video years ago with him?
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys were on a video with me. I think I remember that, ancient, years ago. Because they said Andy's only 22, and I said, who do I know that's around that age? Nicholas. He's my 22-year-old mystic. So anyway, we're going to read a question from Andy, because I think this question is something that some of you have been thinking also, so that's why we're going to read it.
This is a question regarding Plan Bs. This year I decided to finally drop all pursuits and ambitions to only focus on my one true desire, awakening. It has been going great, and I feel great advancements. But recently I have been getting non-stop reflections of Plan Bs. I'm 22 and live with my parents. After losing interest in my business, I did not know how to tell them I quit. Almost every day I get reflections of my belief in Plan B from my parents and extended family. Along with the belief in Plan B, I also feel like a bum.
A bum.
A bum. Since I'm not producing any income to help my parents while living for free at their house, I think what I want to do is give them all my savings and move out so that I can learn divine providence. I haven't received guidance for this specifically, but more importantly, I would like to cleanse my mind of all these beliefs. Feel free to speak on this topic if you feel guided.
Oh, that's so beautiful, Andy. Well, that sounds like the story of my parable. But you're only 22. I lived at my parents' house till I was 28. You're surely going to be out in divine providence before me. You're ahead of me. You're ahead of the game, Andy. I was in there till 28, I think. I was still going back and forth to university and playing the university game and trying to learn stuff and get degrees and all this and this. And then playing with my cat, Mo, which is short for Mohandas K. Gandhi. And having a time of inward time, like, what do I want to do with my life? I was doing that in my 20s in the parable of David. And I was, the course came to me, I think, when I was about 28, right about then. So I think I was back and forth, but I was still taking the course and going down into my parents' basement and reading and launching out into course groups and doing all kinds of fun stuff that was very inspired. But so we can't necessarily say anything that's good or bad or right or wrong about living at home. You know, because all this stuff about independence and being an independent person, everything, that's all ego too. You know, the spirit will use all the symbols of the world. I feel grateful that Jack and Evelyn had me there, and actually Andy, Jack said some of the same words. He would say to me, David, you're a bum. You're a bum. Get a job. You're hearing the same words, Andy. It's so cool. You're doing it at 22. Oh man, that's so fantastic. You're 6 years ahead. You are soaring there. Get a bum. Mine was no good, dirty, rotten bum. Get a job. That was pretty much the phrase. And so really, if you're just being called a bum, you know, that's kind of light. But actually, what happens was I have so much gratitude for them because they were like angels. My cat was like an angel. My parents were like an angel. I have such gratitude for loving parents that let me go to university and experiment and read and pray and meditate in the basement. And it got to be, they were so respectful that I would be meditating for hours and the door would open, the basement door, Dave. So we have some food and supper. If you'd like to join us, you can. Oh, it was, you know, it was like angels. It was spectacular, really, spectacular. So really, it's not so much that you have to give all your money to your parents, walk out the door and say, Mom, Dad, thank you. I'll never see you again. And I'm going out to be like Peace Pilgrim and walking around and to learn divine providence. Actually, it starts with tuning in and with everything. Like, if you have some money, give the money to Jesus and the Holy Spirit immediately. You know, don't, it's like it'll burn a hole in your pocket if you try to keep it as a person. You'll still have guilt if you're trying to hold on to the money or give it away out of guilt. Just give the money immediately over to Jesus and the Holy Spirit and say, this is your money now. What would you have me do with your money? I don't know the way to enlightenment and salvation, but you do, so be you in charge. I give you this holy instant. I give you the body. I give you the money. I give you everything. And then go into prayer and ask if it is that you are to leave your parents, but we never do leave anything behind when we have any kind of resistance to it. I was just hearing about this movie, what was it called, Into the Wild? I think Jeffrey was telling me about that, and even though it was quite a journey, a solo journey, he had mighty companions, angels showing up left and right that adored him, Kirsten said loved him, and yet he had to go through all of his resistances where he had autonomy and independence, that, and in the end, you know, surrender into love, that love is the only important thing that there is, it's the only reality. So you can do that too. And don't feel concerned about the age of the body, 22, because if you just surrender over to spirit and say, Spirit, you guide and direct the way, you will be told, and or you will have these feelings. And if you don't feel anything, Andy, and you don't hear anything, call us up and talk to one of us, because we'll join with you in prayer. And where two or more are gathered in His name, I am there. He is there. So that presence of love is there to guide. But that's a really good question. I think everyone who's joined in today has had some doubts about economics or survival. And Andy is asking a question for everyone. Like, where am I withholding from trusting the Holy Spirit? Is there areas of my life, like finances or sexuality or vocation or family relationships or whatever, is there any of those areas or others that I have not given over to the Holy Spirit yet, and that I'm holding on to and believe that I know better? And it's not like the Spirit will rip anything away from you. If you give your relationship or relationships over to the Holy Spirit, those relationships will be blessed and purified by light and love and joy, to shine the light of love and radiate that light of love. Nothing is taken away. It's just that the specialness, the egoic specialness, gets purified. But that's all. There's no loss involved. Only a purification of specialness. But don't try to skip over and don't try to drop them on your own. Let the Holy Spirit help you drop them. Because if you try to drop them with the ego, they're going to be like flypaper. They're going nowhere. But if the Holy Spirit washes your mind, and they start to fade away, and you feel the lightness around them, then you've really had an experience of love. Thank you, Andy Page. And thank you, Andy in Mexico, too. We love you.
Thank you for coming up after your name is called.
Right. You came right to the camera. You heard, is there an Andy? And you answered the call immediately. I saw myself going like this. When I was just with the young hippies out in Topanga, I was saying, everything is involuntary, everything's under Jesus' control, everything is JC Central. So I was using my hand to go, JC Central, JC Central, them too, JC Central. We had a whole group of us going like this, as we're taking in the divine providence and letting go of thinking we're in control. Yeah. And they told me I do this thing with my hands too. I'm unaware of this, so now I have to pay attention to all these happy mannerisms. But okay, do we have any more questions?
Yeah.
If we have any pressing questions, and then we'll open it up for our live studio audience. But see if anything else jumps out at me.
I have another one from John. Thank you for hosting this time for us. Do you have any advice for one who struggles with deep-seated resentments? These are long-standing, repeated rehashing of events that cause great upset. And this one in particular, for someone who already understands what the Course is saying, were not bodies, and the seeming events were a false experience. Calling on the Holy Spirit so far had not been successful.
Well, that, deep-seated resentments. Well, that reminds me, this is the parable of David. I think, in the parable of David, the personality was very shy and reserved, like a wallflower. I stuffed things down, I mumbled, I swallowed words. I would get comments back from employers, even David swallows his words. I was timid, I was frightened, I was embarrassed. All those things are describing the egoic structure that the Holy Spirit and Jesus had to work with. And also, I think, underneath all of that, I had deep-seated grievances and resentments that I was trying to even be kind of, I guess you could say, polite. David was usually pretty polite, but you know, politeness only can go so far when you have deep-seated resentments. It's like you're sitting on a volcano of hot lava, and you may wear a polite mask. It's like that Barry Manilow song that I like to sing, you know, You remind me I live in a shell, safe from the past and doing okay, but not very well. No jolts and surprises, no crisis arises. My life goes along as it should. It's all very nice, but not very good. And of course, the chorus is even better. But I'm going to use the first part of the song today because I had resentments, deep-seated guilt and anger and resentments. You know, it was under all that politeness and just kind of glazed over eyes and kind of going around like a shadow dancing in the world was I actually had a lot of rage. I had a lot of rage underneath that, huge amount of rage that was pushed down and pushed down, and I spent all this energy. That's why I was so tired. I had fatigue at pushing rage out of awareness. And we could even see that in Snowden, as the movie Snowden, as he goes along and he starts to discover these things. He starts out very conservative, very patriotic, but then as he starts to discover all these things that are secrets, and security is secrets, and secrets, secrets, secrets everywhere he worked, then he couldn't keep a secret anymore. He started to feel like this rage coming up, and it played out as these seizures.
He got sick.
He got sick, and I got sick too. David seemed to get sick in the parable because I was sitting on a volcanic eruption of rage, and I was trying to just not let it up. I didn't want to disappoint the family, disappoint the professors, disappoint friends. I wanted to be shy and quiet and polite, and I didn't get in touch with the rage. So in answer to your question, when I started getting into the course, when I started getting into relationships, all that was buried came gushing up really pretty quickly and very intensely. And it was such a thrust. It was like when a volcanic explosion comes, the lava just thrusts up through the volcano and just spews out, shoots sparks and lava and smoke all over her, miles and miles and miles. That's what happened to me too. Except I thought, they're going to lock me up if I erupt. Most of us have thought that about our rage. That's why we don't let our rage up, right? Mm-hmm. We'll get locked up. Mm-hmm. Or first we'll get reprimanded by our parents. And imagine what your spouse is going to think if you let your rage up. Look for another fish in the sea, you know. I don't want a raging partner. I'm sorry, that's not my idea of romance. You know, so that's going to happen. So what I did was I was into the course and I was into prayer, and I actually said to Jesus, because Jesus was my teacher, how am I going to handle this, because I don't want to get locked up and I've got all this unconscious rage that's starting to come up. And he said, that's why we have hermitages. I said, oh, tell me more about this hermitage option. He said, yeah, so I had a hermitage in this beautiful little lake down in Corinth, near Corinth, Kentucky, Lake Arrowhead, and I went off into a little travel trailer and I went with my Course in Miracles book off into hermitages there. I did a hermitage in Michigan, in the lower part of Michigan, in central Michigan. It was Harrison Township. I had a little hermitage there, small little house in the woods. I had a hermitage in Kansas. I had a hermitage in North Dakota. And I would also have hermitages when I would travel around. I would go to state parks and I would kind of go out in the woods. Sound familiar? You ever heard of Buddha going off and leaving the palace? Where was he going? He went off into hermitage many times. So actually, that's how I handled this these deep-seated resentments, because I could feel that they were just on top of the rage, and the rage had to be allowed to come up. And even at our monastery, all of us here in the room have been to the monastery, you know, I asked Jesus one time about the monastery, why do we have a Course in Miracles monastery? And he said, the rocks can handle your rage. Go out and take a walk in the canyon and rage all you want at those big rocks, those cliffs. The rocks will be so kind and gentle. The rocks will not react and respond to your rage. We've even got a little cave down there, some of you are aware of. You can even take a walk, and if you are through raging, or you're a little embarrassed raging at the rocks, then go in the cave and rage in the cave. You know, there's nobody, there are no eyes watching. You won't even bother the animals. Go in the cage and rage. You know, that's the thing. That's what you have to do. So actually, that's the answer I'm giving you, is that if you pray to Jesus, He will arrange a way for you to let that up in a way that it can move through, and in a way that actually, of course, brings no harm to anyone and anything. Because the whole world is subjective anyway, so you just perceive what you believe. But you have to let go of that rage before you're going to find the happy dream. So that's what I would do. That's what I did. And it was very helpful.
That's beautiful, because it is very gentle, you know. Like, I keep hearing this recently, this word desire. You know, the desire is preceding everything. You know, the healing comes after our desire to heal, and the awareness of God comes after our desire to remember. So in a way, if I have this mixed result, you know, or mixed or confusion, you know, in terms of I don't hear, or I'm not feeling clear, or I don't have result of healing, then I can tell you, let's work on our desire, like go before the what to do part, you know, and whether I'm doing the right thing or the wrong thing, go before that, because if the desire is mixed, then the doing part is gonna be completely confusing, because the doing parts is gonna be arranged according to the desire. So, you know, here we have a small team that works every day using projects and interpersonal relationship, and I guess outside of this little cocoon, people are doing very much the similar thing in form, like working and to the best we can, using the lessons that presented in our daily life to work through our minds. But if forgiveness is not a consistent experience, then you will find you started to find it's boring. It's getting started to be going through the motions. All the actions and the things you do and the relationships start to lose its meaning, because nothing in this world really have any meaning in and of itself. You very soon you will start to feel, okay, there's no meaning in this. There is no vibrancy in this, there is no inspiration in this. But really what happens is, because there is nothing that is really popping in your mind, there's no forgiveness that's really happening on a daily basis that allows the mind to keep going deeper. So, you know, with this deep-seated resentment, or with the question of, with the, you know, plan B's, I would always feel like, let's come back to our desire in the mind and be very, very honest with ourselves. You know, we can be honest when we're alone. There is no consequence to be honest. There is only truth going to be revealed to you by welcoming it, even if it is suppressed, even to our own awareness. You know, we don't really know it for sure, just by sincerely wanting it to be revealed to our minds and say, you know, I want to know, do I really desire this? And this is all that I desire. And if it is not strong enough, because I know I also desire this, I also desire that, and also desire this, then let's just be very honest with it and ask the spirit to work with us with these multiple conflicting desires. Because the desire for God is really all the other desires are in conflict with the desire for God, really. So we just have to allow the spirit to work with us, you know. And I can guarantee you, when the desire for forgiveness is beyond anything, then the experience will come to you. And the doing part and the how part will come to your awareness by you welcoming it. So this is very, very important, and this is very, very practical.
Yeah, it's beautiful. And as we're sitting here, look at the lower right-hand corner.
Yeah, Andy's.
There's Andy. We should, I don't know how our tech is, all we have to do is
I think there is a little chat here,
Eric,
too.
Eric will do it.
Eric, maybe you can read the chat for us.
Yeah, Andy just wrote, "Thanks for answering my question, David. I was watching on Periscope."
Okay, thank you. Oh, I love that, how rapid it is. I think, Andy, are you there? Are you there? I'm through Periscope, yes, and then he sent us the chat. Thank you, Andy. Let us know how it goes. Let us know. Okay, and Eric's capable of letting questions and responses come through from our live audience, and we have most everyone's alive. Kirsten has gone off to La La Land, but we have a mostly live audience here in Camas, and all of you there, and in Mexico. Our beloveds there in Mexico.
Hi.
So if any, yeah, we could field questions or comments or responses, or maybe you want to say yes to the invitation. The other thing too, if you're saying, well, that sounds pretty good to really do what Andy has just said in his email. I want to focus my full attention on this this awakening and this purpose. And he brought up his plan B's and some of the doubt thoughts that were being reflected. I should also mention that Kirsten and Suzanne and I are going to be out with others from the community for a week-long silent retreat that's coming up on the 30th of this month. And I have been told that like we're maxed out like 34, but actually that's the 49-acre monastery does not get maxed out. I don't even believe in that concept. So basically I've heard that that our entire campground and trailers are unused. So I don't mind if another 20 of you decide to come and join in. I know that'll be fun for everybody in our community to, they think they're maxed out, but just come and bring some food, and you can bring a tent, or we'll get you in a trailer. We're not even using our campground. We're not even close to maxed out. So we're just going to go into an experience. So if it's 34 or it's 50 or whatever, you know, we're here, our ovens are working now, we've got everything that we need to do it. And you know, that's just one invitation, but also, like I said, you don't, if you really just give yourself full permission, you can drop into this. And then, as you drop into it, of course the ego will put up its defense, you know, but what about this? And just practice handing those what-ifs and what about, handing those over to the Holy Spirit. Because your mind, there's only one of us, so your mind is so powerful that it's literally moving the stars. It's moving the planets. If it's strong enough to move the planets, don't think that those little doubt thoughts and those little protests have any chance of stopping you from reaching the kingdom of heaven. You're moving the planets, for God's sake. You know, you're moving the planets. So if you sink in your mind and you face resistance and these doubt thoughts, then hand them over. That's what you were just talking about. Go before them.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was trying to say. Not look at the world for reference, you know, not look at the world. Is that allowing me to do this? Is this handled so that I can do this? Are people approved of me to do this? These are, you know, you're worthy more than that. You know, you're worth more than just looking at the world to see what is okay, because the world is there to support you. But it is for us to claim the strength and the certainty from within first. Then the world can reflect, because the world cannot give us what we deny ourselves first. So if we deny, then we look out, and then we keep having reflections. Okay, what, you're crazy, you don't know what you're doing, what about responsibilities in this world? That's just the uncertainty in our own mind, and we need to go back to our desire and trust the spirit, and then claim that certainty. Because I, even talking about the retreat, I just had this example came to my mind. Our friend, a messenger, JP, who first time 7 years ago when he came to join us, he also applied for a retreat, and we were maxed out, and he was on the waiting list, and I heard he was on the number 10 on the waiting list.
10 down.
And with 40 some people already confirmed, so there was a very, very slim chance that he will be, you know, be able to come in. But then right before the retreat, he got a call, you know, he said it took a miracle for him to join, but he got a call from Lisa who said, well, there is a miracle. So he joined us, and I guess he
moved up,
never left.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 8. He moved up and he made it in, and he's never left. So it's just the power of your mind,
yeah,
and your desire.
The desire is strong. Literally, the mind is moving time and space to make room for what is truly important. You know, if the important thing in the mind is about other things, then that's what we get. But then we taste the hollowness and the dissatisfaction of that too. So there is never a victim in this, because we always get what we desire, always. Yeah.
How sweet. How sweet.
Yeah.
Those two things will save you. We always get what we desire, and remember, Jesus is in charge. And he's having a good laugh with all of us. We need to learn to laugh with him at this meaningless world and enjoy the symbols. Enjoy the symbols as they go from ego meaning into zero meaning, and back into the kingdom of heaven we go. So let's enjoy it. As the world starts to fade and fall away, why not have a party with Jesus? Why not really join with the Christ mind and enjoy it as it falls away? Some of you watched the movie The Truman Show. Has anybody, raise your hand if you've seen The Truman Show. You know, at the end, the memories, and you know, he goes through the exit door. You might also remember, anybody remember Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, also with Jim Carrey? You know, at the end of that movie, basically he's holding Kate Winslet's hands and they're trying to run through the mind, and he's trying to protect her because he doesn't want to lose her, and all his memories are being deleted, and they finally get down to the last memory, and she's on, I think, on a beach with him, and she goes, Joel, what are you going to do? This is the last memory. And he says, enjoy it. So it's the last memory deletion. Imagine all the memories, all these false memories of time and space. Jesus is swooping and cleaning and erasing and evaporating all the memories of time and space to bring you back into eternity. And you get down to your final memory. And this final memory is with the Holy Spirit. It's a happy dream. You finally get down for all these other egoic memories to the happy dream, and now you're watching the happy dream, and you get this voice, well, this is the last memory of this world. Enjoy it. Before it disappears, savor it. Enjoy the non-judged world. Enjoy the whole and complete world. Enjoy the beautiful world that the Holy Spirit has made for the mind and the awakening. It says in the Course, there is a maker, capital M, of another world. He's talking about the real world, the happy dream, true perception is what he's talking about. Enjoy that one. And why not enjoy it now? Why wait and delay the happy dream? Why not be more honest and look in your mind to say, what do I value in this world more than the happy dream? And more than eternity. What is it that I'm holding on to? Is it some kind of a body concept? Is it some kind of a self-image concept? Is it friends? Is it family? Is it money? Is it possessions? Is it wanting to go on a spaceship and go into outer space? Maybe you're into mental phenomena. Maybe you liked astral projection and you've only projected yourself to 3 galaxies and you want to go to 100 more galaxies with astral projection before you wake up. Don't do it. Don't do it. It's not worth it. There is no exploration in time and space. It's worth denying the real world and the happy dream. And maybe we could talk a little bit about this book, this PDF file that of this book that I read, 2150 AD by Thea Alexander.
Yeah.
I actually got into metaphysics years ago when I, again, like Andy, I was at my parents' house. They had cable TV. I was up in the middle of the night laying on the couch, bored to death, ship clipping through probably 80, 90 cable stations, bored, still wanting to maybe go to sleep. And then I hit this channel, and they were interviewing Thea Alexander about a book she'd written, 2150 AD. And maybe Francis and I can use this time to talk about, Francis, JP got her the PDF file. Maybe you can just share your impressions of the book, and then we can, as inspiring as it is, in this talk, we're actually saying you can actually even go beyond this kind of higher community that was experienced there.
Yeah, the story is probably a fiction story about some futuristic society that is so transcended of the egoic mind, which they call the micro thinking, you know, is the equivalent of what we call the egoic mind, that they live in this place of the macro society, they call it. And it's very, you know, the thing is, the principle that they use or they live with is called the macro philosophy. And they say that the master macro philosophy is Jesus, basically, because the way they live is complete transparency with their mind, not just with possessions, definitely with possessions, with relationships. Their relationships are not possessive, not codependent, not to be together to get something. The relationship is really for a period of time for them to have a growth together if they are like supportive of the mutual growth in their expansion of awareness, and then they will move on. So relationship is highly collaborative, and the thing is with their mind, because their thoughts are completely transparent in terms of they allow all their thoughts to be received and to be given. There is no holding back or no hiding. So they pretty much live in telepathy because of there is no fear of hiding their thoughts. So they could live in telepathy, but also because everybody is very tuned in, they can see everybody's aura as well. So there is no mistaken of each other's awareness.
Or emotions.
Emotions.
Because you talk about you wear your heart on your sleeve, all your emotions show up in your aura. So you can't, it's like, it's so advanced that there's no hiding how you feel. And then if you can't hide how you feel, you certainly can't hide how you think. And so the auras, everybody's preceding auras. So that is that's where all this is heading, with no private thoughts and no people pleasing.
Yeah, so when this guy, basically he got transmitted to this higher society in his dreams from 1976, where he lived. And he was basically just get introduced to this society and their philosophy. And looking back on where he lived in 1976, it's actually not much different than 2016, really. But in terms of philosophy, in terms of the thought system that we live by, probably in terms of perceptions and how automated things are, is different. But in terms of the underlying philosophy, there's really not much different. But just they were reviewing all the philosophy of this day and age is actually absolutely ridiculous, and there is no real one thing is more ridiculous than the other. It's all ridiculous because it's all based on this notion of we are separate and we can hide from each other, and there is me and there is other, and our action is not going to bring any kind of effect to us. You know, that is like ultimate forgetfulness, is that what the cause is not, you know, is not from within, and what I do have no consequence of. You know, this is also where the victim gonna start, is okay, someone else has caused me to have some kind of internal emotional state or upsets. This is the game of this world. The cause is outside, is not here. And so they're just reviewing, you know, how we get educated, how we got born, even this nuclear family that we think is so natural, it's so loving, and it's so the basis and the foundation of this society is so right, that is still advocate the same thing.
Yeah. So the nuclear family, as most of us have experienced it with mom and dad, maybe brothers, sisters, is a projection of micro thinking. It's a projection of the ego. Really, these characters like Solaris, you know how I show you the movie, Solaris is just a projection of the thoughts that you haven't healed. The biological family that you've been dealing with for all these years is a projection of ego thoughts that you haven't healed. And so basically your biological family, if you heal, if you forgive, they can turn into happy reflections, but if you don't do the inner work, then they're just going to continue reflecting back these egoic grievances and thoughts and patterns that were there before the mind even was a birth and a person that was in the mind.
Yeah. So if you really started to, you know, the book like touch upon something, but if from that point you really look at everything we believe in this world, you know, country, I'm born from a country, you're born from a country, and there's a country interest, you know, all these wars and all this, even the CIA, all these movies, it's about country interest. What is that? Like, really, what is that advocate? What is that based on? What is that reflecting of? Is this micro system, thought system, that we are separate individuals and we need to get the most for ourselves and harm other people that there will be no consequence, you know? And that is absolutely ridiculous from the macro philosophy, which we are one and connected, and you know, it's like there is no victim of anything. So yeah, just really give us a very good like leaping point, really start to look at everything that we believe as real and we believe as natural, we believe as what we should be doing, what is right and wrong in this world. That's why I was saying there is no right in the wrong-minded thinking. There's nothing, you can't find anything that's truly right in the wrong-minded thinking. You know, we can let go, let the whole thing go.
It's a game. If the ego has set up a right versus wrong in this world, and even the idea that persons have their own belief system, that's a joke too. That's all based on private minds, private thoughts, and wow, Snowden, if you're watching me from Russia, from Moscow, good job, good start. Your last decade has been a great, you've made great advances. What's the partner's name? Lindsay. Mm-hmm. You and Lindsay have had a relationship and you've soared and you've let this epilepsy come up and you've let yourself face a lot of these things, and you've done a great service by exposing these private thoughts in your mind. Now's when you've got to kind of take, I don't care whether you take A Course in Miracles, Advaita Vedanta, just some non-dual path that will take you down and show you the ridiculousness of private thoughts, the ridiculousness of protecting information. Not that there's some that are doing it and some that are the victim of it. Come on, we have to go beyond this. The ego's still playing games with this information stuff. Who's got the information? Who controls things? Blame the government. Blame this. Racing around, hiding as if there's people trying to get us. It's a game. It's a game. The ego is a trick. It's made up a projected world with this game going on. And at any time that you want, you can stop and drop. Instead of drop your weapon, it's stop and drop the belief in private thoughts and private minds. Stop and drop. That's what's going on. That's the only escape. There is no security in the world. There are no defenses. There is no encryption. There is no servers that can be protected or invaded. All this thing of countries and, you know, what the Chinese are doing and what the Russians are doing, what the Americans are doing, and who's hacking into who and hacking into banking systems. You know, there was a young Chinese man, I think he invented this file sharing system back when he was maybe 16, he was a teenager, Nutella, and he developed this file sharing system where files could be shared freely from device to device, computers, all across the world. Some of you, I don't know if some of you ever remember Napster. This is getting back into history. Remember Napster tried to put music for free for everybody on the internet, and there was a big outrage by the community of artists and so on and so forth. And they had one central server where they kept all the music and they shared it out with everybody in the world. Guess what they did? They shut down the server. But this Chinese boy invented a system where you could share device to device with no central monitoring system. Holy Spirit. Woo! Holy Spirit. Total 100% sharing. No possessing. Can't be controlled. The ego got to him. He committed suicide. But I'm using this example of this young man from China because, wow, isn't that, as much as the internet is a reflection of our connectedness, free file sharing. Nothing can be classified, nothing can be codified. That'll scare the bejeebies out of the ego. Ego is, that'll scare the bejesus out of the ego because what can be shared? What did we learn from Jesus in A Course in Miracles? Only the thoughts of God can be shared. Only the thoughts of God can be shared. Private thoughts cannot be shared. They don't even exist, but they can't be shared. And this world is the ego projection, is the attempt to share the impossible, to share fear, to share doubt, to share anger. When you go to your partner, you say, let me get all the rage and anger off my chest, and you blast the partner, you're keeping it. You're not getting it off your chest. You are keeping it. Only the thoughts of God can be shared. That's the divine law. So when you share love, you experience love, because in the giving and the receiving are the same. And when you share thoughts of God, you experience yourself as you truly are, and as everything truly is, pure spirit. So this is why we have a community that talks about no private thoughts and no people-pleasing. This is why we enjoyed the Beatles, we enjoyed Snowden, because of this deep, deep teaching. And it's not a matter of whether the government's ready or... Remember, these are all just concepts and projections. Yeah. It's your mind, your own mind, the mind. Yeah. Are you desiring the peace and happiness and freedom of God's love?
Yeah, we're ready and we are ahead of this ego game in our mind, and we have to be confident with it. You know, like let's go, let's break the grounds and let's keep going forward without looking at anything for reference here, because they're not a worthy reference here. They're wrong-mindedness. Like, keep going forward, you know, and that's the support we can give each other.
Yeah. Go forward. Don't look back. Don't look left. Don't look right, don't look up, don't look down, and please, you know, this is in the Bible. If you have to go back to the Old Testament, don't look back or you'll turn into a pillar of salt. Remember that one? Some of those old movies, the Ten Commandments, and how graphic that was. Don't look back. Don't look back to the past or you'll freeze into a self-concept. That's what that meant. You know, don't look back or you'll turn into a pillar of salt. Just don't look back to the past or you'll freeze into an unreal self-concept that God didn't create and really doesn't even know anything about.
You become so nothing.
You become a shadow, a lost shadow, if you look back and try to embrace the past. So what does that mean? Don't look back to the past. That means you don't even have to be sentimental anymore. You don't have to be nostalgic. You know, you can free your mind even from those, you know, nostalgic songs like Billy Joel's Piano Man, you know, or, you know, looking back, you know, remember Paul McCartney's song, Yesterday? Love was such an easy game to play. Now I need a place to hide away. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Listen, that was a hit. That was on the Ed Sullivan Show when the Beatles first came. He performed that. That's the ego singing, you know, Yesterday. There's nothing great about yesterday. People say, what about your fond memories of the past? I don't have any fond memories of the past. It's like there is nothing attractive about the past at all. It's like you don't have to kind of go back and long for something, you know. What was that Nielsen song? I can't live if living is without you. I can't live. I can't give anyone. Oh, come on. Come on. Now that is ridiculous. That is ridiculous. That's the most codependent song. You better turn that to God. I can't live to God if living is without you. Now then you've got a song. But please don't sing that to a partner. My God. If you think that you can't live without a body, then you don't even know what life is. You don't have a clue what life is. And so we could probably come up with our all-time favorite sappy codependent love songs, but just to have a good laugh at the ridiculousness of all of it and say, that's enough of it. We're not going to waste an instant. We're not going to waste this holy instant on all those like things that are something in the past. It was something that we need to go back to. We don't look back. Don't turn back.
Turn inward, because there is a reference that is worthy of you, and that is only within. And that every time we look outside, it's basically deny this inner guide to say, I mean, this is not worthy. I have this to look at, I have this to satisfy, this to please. But no, like, turn your head to inward, like, ask inner, and that is really reflective of your desire. How much do you want the Spirit's guidance? How much? How much do you ask? How much do you really pause and withdraw all your reference from this and from that and say, I only ask this, and tell me. This will reflect your desire, and this will tell you, you know, how much you desire it, and this will give you the clarity if you desire it fully.
Okay.
Wow. Thank you.
There's Dan getting a thumbs up from Arizona. Oh, precious.
And thank you for joining from Europe as well, because we have a retreat in Europe coming this weekend as well. We have a retreat coming here in the monastery with David, Kirsten, and Suzanne.
Yeah.
And so, it's like, there are a lot of support that can join in.
I see you, Sonia. I see you. We've got a retreat coming up in a weekend in Portugal next.
Yeah, in December.
June.
Oh yeah.
Well, there's one in December. There's one in December, Algarve.
Yeah.
And then there's one coming up in. Case.
There's a one near Lisbon.
Near Lisbon, coming up in June 16th, 17th, 18th. That's way off this next 2017.
Yeah, but I just want to say that thank you for joining, and we are here. We're together in this, all of us, all the way. Mm. Yeah. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.